teacher at Seattle Central Community College, a member of AFT Local 1789. So please give it up for our brassy candidate, Shama
politicians. And for people like us, it is quite overwhelming to have this kind of attention. But what I had said at that time, which I really meant every word of it, and I'm going to say again, I am happy and honored to carry this mantle for the global working class. Like me, you know that we like to talk a lot.
Yeah.
So if at any point in time you know you get tired of my speaking, you'll know why it is I'm going on.
No.
We won't get
so,
tired.
Okay. So the first thing, of course, needless to say, I'm having a hard time not using F words to describe how I feel right now. You fill them in for me.
Fuck capitalism!
Woo! I think this is both an incredible result, but not that surprising in the sense that we know that times are changing, and we know that we have run this campaign at a time when Occupy has completely shifted the dialogue. It has put class back on the agenda. Back on the agenda, and it has put the S word, socialism, back on the agenda. And for all those naysayers who kept telling us, you know, I like your campaign, but why are you running openly as a socialist? Don't you know that there is stigma against the ideas of socialism and even the word? I invite them to look at the King County website today. Of the Democratic and Republican parties, I want them to hear our loud and clear voice. We are coming after you.
That's right.
We are coming because we are sick and tired of the corporate agenda, we are sick and tired of capitalism, and we are determined to fight for ourselves and for our brothers and sisters. And I also wanted to say a word about the other ballot initiatives that succeeded. We know the marijuana initiative passed. I think and I also wanted to say that as far as we know, for now, the marriage equality initiatives, both in the state of Washington and the state of Minnesota, have passed. Why we've seen these changes? Why are these progressive initiatives passing? Why has our campaign seen such spectacular results? It's because the times are changing, and we better realize that and wake up to it, because we've got a job to do. And most of my speech is of course going to be celebratory, but I am going to end on a sober note. Trust me, because this result has not only shown us how successful we can be, but it has also placed an enormous responsibility on us collectively, because we cannot stop here. We cannot pretend that getting 27% against Frank Chop is the end of the road. No, it's only the beginning. Yeah! And look at this. You know, in a year, I just request you not to interrupt, because there'll be lots of time for discussion. You know, we've heard from other speakers how brazenly and shamelessly corrupt this presidential year has been. The record amounts of money spending, $3 billion. Do you know how many students can go to college with $3 billion? Do you know how many home foreclosures can be prevented with $3 billion? Do you know how many jobs can be created, living wage jobs? I mean, look at this completely corrupt system of capitalism that has no accountability whatsoever to the needs of the 99% and is very clearly slanted towards the greed of the 1%.
That's right.
Yeah.
And in the middle of all this slime of corruption and corporate agenda, we have this campaign shining as a beacon to show everybody this is how we organize a fight back. This is how we organize a struggle. And the results of this campaign are showing that there is a lot of seething anger among ordinary people in America, among the working class, and clearly we are at a time when that anger should find clear expression, and we have something to offer in that regard. And we should also recognize, you know, based on what Stefan, our international speaker, said, that this is not an isolated event. What is happening in the United States is not an isolated event. This is happening all over the world. The global fires of the working class have been ignited, and we are heading towards an era of struggle. And I urge you, I appeal to you all, to be with us there, shoulder to shoulder, when we organize those movements against the capitalist class. But you know, it's not just enough to say, "Well, I hate capitalism. You know, I want to fight back." We also have to know what we are fighting for, and the job of socialists is to point the way forward. And we are not shy about it. We invite people to debate with us on ideas of socialism, but we are not shy, and we have been proven resoundingly correct that we should not be shy, because there is no excuse for being shy or reticent when you're talking about such serious issues as fighting against the enormous misery that capitalism unleashes on us all over the world. So let's be clear about that. Let's not be shy. This is not a time for modesty. This is a time for boldness and courage.
Yeah!
Yeah! And how did we raise this banner of socialism through our campaign? We didn't just say, "Hey, if you're tired of capitalism, join us, we're socialists." No, if you looked at our leaflets, we had a very detailed and well thought out program. We called for the raising of the minimum wage to $15 an hour. We talked about carrying out a massive jobs program to create living wage jobs for ordinary workers. We're calling for free public education, high quality education for all, for everybody, not just the youth. We're calling for free public transit, high quality public transit. And you know, every time I mentioned this, our opponent, Frank Chop, said, "Well, you know, you gotta get things done. It's not just enough to talk about it." And we want the Democrats to know, to hear us today. We are doing what needs to be done, and you better watch out. Yeah. And did we raise these demands because we were under the illusion that we were actually going to achieve all that in this election campaign? No, we were well aware that it was not going to change today, but we had to take the first steps. And for all those, again, you know, those other naysayers who will tell you, why are you supporting a grassroots campaign? They're not going to win anyway. Tell them that would you build a skyscraper on the 10th floor or would you lay the foundation first?
Yeah.
And if you use that logic in physics, then why don't you use it in politics? Let's build the building blocks.
Yeah.
We have a vision for the future world. We also have strategies and tactics about how to achieve that. It is not going to be easy. I am not going to sugarcoat it. It is going to be hard, but this is the only way to struggle against a brutally unjust system. And, you know, as other speakers have pointed out, not only were we not shy about saying we're socialists, we went to court for our right to call ourselves socialists. We took King County, the Attorney General, and the Secretary of the State of Washington to court, and we defeated them.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We know that all the problems that we're talking about, you know, poverty, homelessness, student debt, the massive student debt that, you know, I'm going to digress for a minute and say, listen, if you want to fight against student debt, there is only one way to fight against it. We have to organize a revolt, and we have to say, that's it, we're not going to pay. And there are examples all over the world and also in history which show that the laws of the rich are unenforceable if the working class refuses to obey those laws. We also know that the crisis of climate change is not going to be solved under capitalism. So let's, again, let's not be shy because we don't have the time. We don't have the luxury to hold ourselves back and be nice about it. No, let's actually be out there and be boldly arguing for this. And of course, every time you'll say that, they will tell you that, well, you know, we can't do these things. We can't disturb, you know, corporate America. We can't really tax the wealthy. We can't tax Boeing. Because if we tax them, then they're going to leave the state. And that is why, supposedly, we have to live in a state which has the most regressive tax system in the entire country. And my response to that, again, you know, it's not something I can say on stage, but but the point is this. Both as a Marxist and an economist, I can tell you, there is a grain of truth in that. Yes, corporations under capitalism will always lead if they can find a more favorable terrain for maximizing their profits. So whether or not we have the worst tax system for us, they will leave as long as there are better conditions for them elsewhere. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because I want everyone here to know that this struggle can be successful only if we understand that our interests are linked with the interests of our brothers and sisters everywhere in the world. So as long as... labor, which is more desperate and poorer than us to work at even lower wages than we do, whether it's in South Carolina or in the Philippines, the jobs will move. So if we accept the logic of capitalism, then we are inevitably accepting this race to the bottom. So we have to first reject that idea of race to the bottom and say, no, we won't accept it. And you know what? If the Boeing executives want to leave, they're welcome to leave. The factories are here, the workers are here, the talent is here, the creativity is here. We can run our own workplaces, we can run our own schools. I don't want the administration telling me anything at school. I'm a teacher, I know what to do. Workers know what to do. And look at Hurricane Sandy. Who is helping? Who is doing the maximum amount of work, giving the you know, the worst afflicted food and you know, energy sources?
Occupy.
We don't need the bosses to control us just so that they can make massive profits. Because we're doing the work, we're the ones doing the work anyway. And there are more than enough examples that show how much power, how much latent power we have in our hands. Yes, the one person has the military, they have the police, you know, who have been tear gassing and rubber bulleting us for ages, especially activists and people of color. They have all the billions of dollars, but we have the billions of people with us. Look at the success of the struggle of students in Quebec. Look at the successful strike action taken by the Chicago Teachers Union. I mean, there is more and more examples of how the working class, the youth, the elderly, the disabled, everybody can come together and fight together. Look at our job defense campaign. You know? So, okay, here comes the sober part. So, where are we going to go from here? Are we all just going to go home and drink and have a hangover and forget about it? I mean, I'm okay with you having a hangover, but what do we do from here? You know, this is the most important thing. I mean, even if we had got 5% of the vote, I was going to say the same thing, you know, that we should continue struggling. But we need to think seriously about what this victory means today. Getting 27% of the vote, you know, the numbers will fluctuate, but, you know, for now, this has placed an enormous responsibility on our shoulders, because we have to, you know, build on this success, because if we don't, it will be a completely wasted opportunity. All that work that each of you put in this campaign will be wasted if we don't continue building on it. So I wanted to say, everybody's worked hard on this campaign, take a break, have Thanksgiving, you know, relax, eat and drink, make merry. But then after that, let's all come back and get to work. And but what does that mean? What does getting to work mean? You know, we have to have concrete ideas. Look at the struggles in Greece that Stefan talked about. There's been any number of general strikes going on there. How is it that these enormous mass movements that are out on the streets are not able to actually shift the system? The reason is that we not only need our anger to be channeled, but we also need our ideas to be channeled. We need a way forward. And as I said, we're not shy about it. We think that the future, the way of the future, is socialism. And I invite you all who haven't really had a conversation with us, I can see many faces here that I haven't seen before, which, by the way, is always a great sign. I invite you all to have serious conversations with not just me, but, you know, everybody else here who's in Socialist Alternative, and find out. Ask us tough questions. Ask us, why are you a socialist? Why do you think that socialism is the way of the future? Why can't I just be anarchist? Why can't I just boycott the elections? Why should I be doing all this? It's important to ask these questions, because therein lies the power. We have to show the way forward for everybody else, and we have to participate in mass movements. But not only that, with our phenomenally spectacular result that we've got tonight, we are making this really clear call for the left in Seattle to come together, and we are calling for a broad slate of candidates to be run on the left against the Democratic Party in the Seattle City Council races, in the mayoral races, in 2013. We're not going to wait. And you know, have you heard this thing? They always say, not this year. You know, do it another time, not this year. No, no more. It was this year. Look what we were able to achieve. And next year it's going to be even bigger. So please don't just go home and forget about all this. Let's start building this whole program of running candidates against the Democratic Party. I also wanted to say, I don't know how many people are here from the labor movement, but if the left really wants to succeed, then we have to challenge the labor leadership. I'm going to be bold here and say that the labor leadership in the last 30 years has completely betrayed the working class. They are hand in glove with the Democratic Party, pouring in hundreds of thousands of dollars to their campaigns, and they tell their rank and file workers, you have to be happy with these crumbs. Our union is telling us, you have to be happy with the fact that you're not getting cost of living increases for 10 years. You have to be happy with the fact that 70% of faculty in higher education are now casualized. You have to be happy with the fact that when you get a PhD, you also have to go to the food stamps office because you can't get a job to actually pay your rent. So we want rank and file workers to challenge their own union leadership and say, enough with this, we have to build our own movement. We have to be out of the streets protesting massively against the budget cuts, against this betrayal of the Democratic Party and the union leadership, and we have to run our own candidates. The unions need to break from the Democratic Party. They need to run. They need to run their own grassroots candidates. I mean, look at the amount of money SEIU and these big unions put into the Democratic races. Look at the number of foot soldiers they bring out to stump for Obama. If even a fraction of that power was on the side of grassroots campaigns, what more could we have achieved? Yeah. You know, we have to raise that vision.
Yeah.
And I also think that this evening would be incomplete if I didn't call out the local unions for their shameful behavior in endorsing Frank Chop in a race where there was no Republican. There was no lesser evil. There was a better choice, and they refused to take it. And I'm going to acknowledge the unions that did support us, but I think the time has come where we have to pose a sharp challenge to the corrupt union leadership and build layers of the rank and file, just like the Chicago Teachers Union did. So we have to take this message, not just in spirit, but in concrete terms, you know, actually be out there and talking to people. And I also wanted to, while I'm, you know, saying sobering things, also wanted to recognize that we are, you know, we are understandably, and, you know, it's good that we're overwhelmed by our success, but let's not forget that in the presidential races, who has won? Wall Street.
Yeah.
Wall Street has won again. And if you look at the numbers, the right-wing candidate, Gary Johnson, actually has made bigger gains than Jill Stein, the candidate we were endorsing. So what lesson does this have for us? This is telling us that there is a change in dialogue. We know that people are looking for alternatives. There is an open space. But if the left does not get its act together and grab that space, meaning us, if we don't challenge the corporate agenda and actually occupy that space, occupy the political space, the right wing will raise its ugly head.
Yeah.
And that, my brothers and sisters, would be extremely unfortunate. So let's be really aware of the tasks that are ahead of us. I mean, imagine if not just me, but hundreds of candidates were being run by the Occupy movement today. Where would we have been?
Yeah.
You know? Just a few more things, and then I want to have a vote of thanks for different people. So just please bear with me. But I wanted to say that, you know, when the activists who were fighting for civil rights, you know, when Martin Luther King and everybody else was marching on the streets, when the abolitionists were fighting to end slavery, when the many colonial revolutions happened, even the youth that were on Tahrir Square last year, you know, really taking on very courageously the Mubarak regime, when they were doing that in the moment, they did not think that, you know, I'm doing this because I'm making history. They were thinking, I'm doing this because it is absolutely necessary, and if it means that it takes my life, I'm still open to it because I need to do this for everybody else. And I think that's the kind of dedication and commitment we need from everybody, not just the people in this room, but all your friends and everybody else that you're talking to. But I wanted to say that while we don't do these things because we are making history, we are actually making history. And this is the last thing I'll say before I give a vote of thanks, but I invite you to join us in the making of history. I need to go through this list. Obviously, needless to say, I'm not going to mention every name, the name of every person who has helped us with this campaign. So before I mention...